You guys hear me okay? Good. The good thing is I can't see anybody in the audience right now because I'm being blinded by these lights. So if you've got any questions or anything and I don't recognize you, just yell out. And also we've got these microphones in the aisles here. If you've got any questions during our Q&A session at the end, just feel free to come up and blurt them out or interrupt or however you'd like to interject that. Welcome to our session. My name is Rob Young. I'm with Red Hat. I'm here with Chris Merz from NetApp and with Amrith Kumar from Tesora. We are here to talk about expanding DBaaS workloads with OpenStack Trove. And the cool thing about this is we are also working together on a spec and a blueprint on how we can extend the storage options for Trove to include Manila. So if you're a system administrator, you're very familiar with legacy applications, mode one applications, if you were in today's keynote, you'll find this very interesting because you can now plug in, or you will be able to plug in Trove database as a service applications into the traditional file system implementations that you should be very comfortable in working with. So let's go ahead and get started. We're going to save our questions for the end. We're going to have an open discussion Q&A session at the end, so bear with me. Our agenda for today is I'm going to kick it off. Again, I'm Rob Young with Red Hat. I work with our OpenStack team. I'm a technical product manager, so I work very closely with engineering on our Red Hat OpenStack platform. I'm going to hand the ball to Amrith when we get to the database as a service discussion to talk about Trove, the architecture, the benefits to using Trove in a public and hybrid cloud environment over, you know, some of the other options. Chris is going to take over to talk about the Manila-specific storage option that we have, the architecture there, the file system. We'll have some key takeaways, and then we'll have some open discussion. So just real quickly, if you guys were in the keynote this morning, you know, there was a really good discussion from the Gartner folks about mode one and mode two applications. You know, this should be near and dear to a lot of people's in this room's heart because, you know, mode one is the traditional enterprise application that we have out there around accounting, around just making sure our business is doing what it should. But mode two is probably why most of us are here right now because of OpenStack and innovation and how those two need to be married. And the problem that we're seeing right now is just overall applications are more dynamic now. The lady who gave the talk this morning from Gartner was spot on when she said, you know, more than 41% of revenue will come from digital-based applications. And these are applications that, you know, can't be delivered via waterfall technology. They have to be, you know, from concept to deployment, days versus weeks or months. So this is a big problem, time to market. A lot of pressure on guys like me, on people in this room to deliver on that. The other thing is developers need a quick way to deploy databases that they're going to be testing with and doing QA on and, you know, writing documentation against. If you've come from a development environment like I have, 20 years ago, 10, 15 years ago, I had to go to a DBA to request such databases. Things like MySQL, MariaDB, those things didn't exist. You know, I was working with Oracle and SQL Server and other things, and I needed a DBA to set up my test environments, not only for, you know, my development cases, but for rolling over into production. And, you know, nowadays, that just can't happen. The DBA can't be a bottleneck in this case. So the other thing is the TCO that, you know, comes along with database as a service or just deploying databases in general is a lot higher in the public realm. If you've got a private option to do these things, you can dramatically cut your costs from an AWS or, you know, some of the other public providers that are out there. So we just want to talk about, you know, some of these problems and how we are working together to solve them as a trio. So if you look at OpenStack right now, there is pain that comes with success. So if you look at the overall core components, and I've got the four here because I think Keystone is a big part of this as well, security. But when you talk about networking, compute, and storage, as these things have matured and people have, you know, seen them stabilize within their environment. They know how to administer them. They know how to deploy them. They're looking for additional ways to save money or to innovate within their own environment. So the survey that was mentioned this morning in the keynote, 97% of the people say they want a standardization of APIs. 92% want to avoid vendor lock-in, blah, blah, blah. But 66% want to save money. And when you look at things like, you know, the ancillary services, like as a service for Trove, for Sahara, for file systems, things like that, these are things that can easily be brought into any of these reasons why people move to OpenStack as a justification. And if you look at the number one thing, the number one as a service component that people are adding after their core components have matured and have stabilized, it's Trove and database as a service. And we didn't make this up. We actually, you know, pulled this directly from the user survey. And talking to customers, this is pretty much the trajectory that we see as well as a company at Red Hat. So enter database as a service. And you know, the reason why I think people are looking at this as a very attractive option for them, Trove specifically, is because it allows a higher granular level of control for developers, for people that need databases quickly and can stand them up and burn them down very quickly. It also lowers the TCO of building versus, you know, renting something from AWS for a platform. And the cool thing about DBaaS nowadays is it's not only limited to open source databases as traditionally has been found. Tesora, Amrith will talk about this in just a minute, they provide proprietary options as well. So if you wanna spin up your own database as a service in-house on a private or a hybrid cloud, you can do that on the platforms that you typically wouldn't have been able to just a few years ago. So OpenStack DBaaS, specifically the Trove project, you know, this is a mature, it's a maturing, I should say, a big tent project, and Chris will talk about this a little bit in just a couple of minutes, but it's gonna provide the flexible storage options for database creation, stand up and burn down, for backups, for, you know, the different needs that you're gonna traditionally have found a DBA needing to service. But you're also going to find storage options on the back end that are somewhat limited right now, but growing all the time. This is where innovation comes in. And the traditional use cases that I mentioned before around the Mode 1 applications, enterprise-wise, these are going to be much more of a topic when DBaaS and Manila are integrated. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Amrith from Tesora. He's going to walk you through Trove specifically, the architecture and the advantages of DBaaS.
Thanks, Rob. You guys able to hear me okay? As Rob said, I can't see you, so. So let's talk briefly about database as a service. My name's Amrith. I am with Tesora, or the Trove company. I'm also the PTL of the Trove project for the Newton cycle. So as Rob said, the benefits of database as a service are that it's much more than just provisioning. If you wanted to do just provisioning, you could do it a million ways. You could use Ansible or Puppet or Chef or whatever. But unlike other parts of your application, a database is one thing which once you create it is going to stick around for a long time. So provisioning is just the beginning. Once you provision a database, you got to make sure that it's continuously maintained, it's secure, it's up to date with whatever patches you need. And from time to time, you need to do things like take backups. But databases are also complex beasts in another way. Nobody runs a single instance database in production. So in order to achieve high availability, performance, you use things like replication and clustering. And for anybody who set up a database, setting up a database as a single instance is hard. It's boring after a while. But setting up clustering or replication is painful. And no industry at this point is using a single database in their enterprise. You have multiple databases, each of which does these things in a different way. So the motivation of database as a service, very simply, is to reduce your cost, but more importantly, to reduce your risk and to make it easier for you to consume databases in your enterprise. So the benefits of database as a service are drive down your cost, make it safer and easier to use your databases. And we'll talk more about how some of this stuff works. So since we're going to be delving a little bit into the details of how Trove works, I'm going to give you a brief overview of the Trove architecture. Trove is a maturing Big Tent project. It's been around for a while. And it consumes the services from the core OpenStack components, which are on the right-hand side. I don't know if you're able to see the little dot, but there's Nova on top, Cinder, Swift, Glance, Neutron, and Keystone, the core OpenStack services which you need. If you were to provision a database instance through Trove, which is the service on the left, you talk to the Trove API, and there's other service components within Trove which do the actual things that Trove has to do. Your actual compute instance is coming to you from something which Nova is going to give you. The storage you get is going to be something, your persistent storage for your database at this point in time is necessarily going to be a Cinder volume. Either that, or you're provisioning something like Redis, and you don't need persistent storage and you're using an ephemeral volume. But the whole gist of this talk is, in order to get mature applications to use databases, you need more flexibility in that storage area, and we're talking about how we're going to improve that. When you want to do things like replication or clustering or backups, we use Swift for some intermediate storage. That is something which we want to extend as well. There's some work underway to make Ceph a possibility for that, but just Swift or Ceph is not the answer. We need to have more flexibility in that area as well. If you have a question, unless it's really quick, can we hold it to the end? Okay, great question. The question is, when I say replication of the database, do I mean erasure coding? Okay, answer is no. Trove provides you with an abstraction for a database. So let me tell you what replication I talk about. Give me a single instance of MySQL, which basically means what you're going to get is a Nova compute instance with MySQL running on it. It's a single database. Give me a replicated pair of MySQLs, says, give me one master and multiple slaves, where the data is maintained by the database, with Postgres replication is by the database. Trove does not physically implement replication. Trove uses whatever capability your database has for replication or clustering. So the clustering which Trove provides is the database's native clustering. So we say cluster of Mongo instances, it's Mongo clustering we talk about, okay? So Trove is going to be a consumer of the services of the other OpenStack projects. And we support about a dozen databases at this point, some relational, some non-relational databases. But the most important thing to remember is we automate a lot of workflows. We do not physically implement the mechanism by which the database must do replication. We use whatever the database does for replication, and we give that to you as a managed service. That's what Trove does. We do not physically implement backup. Whatever mechanism the database has for backup, and we'll talk about backup as a specific example in a second, we give you that capability. We simplify configuration management as well. So let's take an example specifically of backup. One of the very important things about Trove is we do not want to reinvent the wheel. So let me give you an example of how something like backup works. Every database technology has a notion of backup. So let me talk about, say, Postgres. You can do backups with Trove in Postgres in one of three different ways. You can do a database dump. You can use Percona backup, Percona extra backup, or you can do incremental backup. So Trove implements a notion of a strategy to do the backup. The user requests a backup of Trove. Trove uses the database native backup utility as a strategy and then sends the data at this point to a place which is Swift. The goal is that in the future, that storage should be abstracted in such a way that you can use not just Swift, but Cinder or Manila. people who've used Oracle have for a long time realized that running a database on a NFS share is a great way to do things. In the cloud, one of the restrictions you have, and this is, you know, whether it's the Amazon cloud or traditionally the OpenStack cloud, if you have a Cinder volume, an EBS volume, you can attach it to one and exactly one VM at a time. Which means if you want to run something like a database with shared storage, this is not possible. However, running databases with shared storage is a very, very common and important use case. So how do we do that? So let's talk about maybe some of the use cases which are going to need that. Like Rob talked about originally, there's three primary things which people do with the database. There's the developer who just wants to quickly spin up a database and try something out. For that person, a single instance, a single VM is perfectly satisfactory. However, there's a person who wants to QA a system. When you QA a system, you want to test some things which are slightly more robust. What happens to the system if some infrastructure fails? How do we recover? For that, you need something like clustering or replication. And at the far end of the spectrum, you may want to have a production database. One of the important things of Trove's model is by not reinventing the wheel and just using the primitives for compute, in this case, that Nova provides us. On the far end of the spectrum with bare metal, we can use Nova with the ironic driver and get bare metal. Everybody knows about VMs in the middle. That's the bread and butter of Nova. On the far left, you can use either small VMs with small flavors, or you could use the Nova Docker driver, Nova Compute LXD, or something like that. Use a flavor, and use the flavor to drive the hypervisor you want. All three are provided today. Bare metal and VMs work just fine. If you want to use containers, you have to do a little bit more, and there's sessions to talk about that at the summit. But at the end of the day, what I want to highlight is Trove's architecture builds on the other projects. And by not reinventing the wheel, we can support a very broad variety of use cases. So one specific use case from a database perspective, which we want to address, which is particularly important to people running applications with significant amounts of data. So take the example on the left-hand side. I have a developer who, or I have a QA organization which has a database. Let's say it has 200 gigabytes of data. And they want to quickly provision an instance so that a QA person, a test person, can run some tests. The notion is they have sample data and they want to quickly provision a bunch of instances with that same data set. And when they're done with it, they're going to destroy the instances. Very common use case. Fine? There's an entirely different use case for a production database. And let's assume that that vertical sequence down there is a time series. At say 10 in the morning, it's fine. 3 in the afternoon, it's fine. At 6 in the evening, it's fine. At 9 in the night, it's fine. And then something goes horribly wrong. A production use case for this is to say, at the point where you find that it's not OK, just revert to the previous use case. OK? Now, if you think about this from a storage perspective, these two models are two very classic use cases for snapshots. The sample data is a snapshot. Every point in time is a snapshot. The example on the left is snapshots with cloning. The example on the right is snapshots without cloning. Currently, the mechanisms which Trove has to do backups do not leverage these smart capabilities which storage have. So if any of you has used storage from, for example, NetApp, and Chris is going to talk about this in more detail, these are things which are available today with the storage subsystems, and Trove is not using. So what we are planning to do is to improve the integration so that when you have a 200 gig data set and you want to launch a new database, the answer is not make the new database and load 200 gigabytes of data. The answer should be clone the snapshot and you're up and running much faster. And the example on the right is not take a backup every time of your 2 petabyte database and then be offline for, you know, unknown numbers of days when you restore it. The answer is revert your snapshot, which with some storage subsystems is a matter of seconds. Both of these are real production use cases which people want on their databases, which are operated by Trove, which is what we plan to do. So with that, let me hand it over to Chris, who's going to talk more about how some of these things are done with Manila, which we're going to be talking more about later.
Thanks, Amrith. I really can't see anybody. That's better. So my name's Chris Mers, and I work for SolidFire, now part of NetApp. And I'm going to talk today and continue talking about the Manila project and integration into Trove Database as a Service. So basically, just to give you an idea of what Manila is, a brief overview, it provides shared file system as a service with an OpenStack, addressing a critical gap in the OpenStack storage services coverage. And it basically enables a new category of on-demand file storage based on infrastructure as a service. To put that simply, Manila does for shared file systems what Cinder does for block storage. Basically, you can provision file shares via self-service API, and so a tenant could say, you know, I'd like a 1 terabyte file share and make it available to this particular network range of hosts. And then Manila will manage the share security and handle the plumbing of the underlying network and storage artifacts. The project began back in 2013, and it was basically a fork of the Cinder project, since the shared file services was not something that was within the eventual charter of Cinder. And at that point, the architecture is fairly similar, except in areas where divergence was necessary to cover the complexities of shared file systems. It's production proven. There's nearly 24 drivers for back-end storage and active feature development. There's one of the most interesting things is the file share types, which is very, very similar to Cinder volume types, which allows you to expose the underlying characteristics of the storage architecture that you're actually using. And in many ways, this is one of the keys to the integrations that Amrith was talking about. The ability to utilize storage capabilities within the context of Trove and Database as a Service is something that is very, very interesting to a lot of people, and is where you can truly accelerate the benefits of the entire architecture together. The idea that you can use snapshots, as was mentioned, or clones to speed up operational activities such as making copies of data sets, backup and restore, this is not just an incremental improvement, this is a radical change of mindset. In some cases, increasing speeds of data transfer two orders of magnitude, because you're actually pivoting the database architecture around the place where the data exists on the storage itself. And this is one of the goals of further integration of the various storage projects into Trove. We see, and our customers have told us specifically that this type of integration, as we're talking about with Manila into Trove, is a critical bridge for enterprise adoption. There are basically three ways in which you're going to be using storage. There's going to be object, block, and file. That's the triumvirate of storage. And with the Manila project, that gap is complete. We've got it all covered now. It doesn't matter if you're using Fibre Channel. It doesn't matter if you're using iSCSI, and it doesn't matter if you're using NFS. You can adopt OpenStack and Trove in the way that best suits your infrastructure investment, both in terms of the hardware and the skill set. So the idea here is that there are many, many traditional core mode 1, mode 2 apps that are designed for shared file system. And this has been the case for many, many years, decades. And by lowering the migration barriers for enterprises, and we're encouraging people to step into OpenStack in a way that is familiar and comfortable to them. Let's talk a little bit about the Manila architecture. If you know anything about the Cinder architecture, this is going to look fairly familiar to you. Commands come in via the REST API or the Horizon dashboard. The Auth Manager acts as a gateway. From there, the scheduler, the API, interact with the stateful data in the SQL database, and the messaging queues interact with the drivers. And you can have many different types of shares with many different backend drivers. So in that case, like I said, it's a fairly similar architecture to Cinder, but the capabilities of the underlying storage systems are going to be surfaced through the driver, and that's going to let the system know what type of storage you can provision as a share type and what its capabilities are going to be, whether it has snapshot capability, some idea of what the performance is going to be, and that type of thing. And by surfacing this further into Trove, the idea is to allow, when you go into provision databases in Trove, to choose your storage type as an option. There's not just a default when you set up the system, but actually have, create database classes and say, well, this is test dev of a particular type, so we're going to need a large volume, low performance shared file system for this. Or this is going to be a production database. We're going to need a high performance Cinder volume for this, or depending on what type of database you're deploying. And some databases are really well suited for using shared file systems. Oracle is one of them. And as you have enterprises who are exploring OpenStack orchestration, exploring Trove database as a service orchestration, they're going to ask the questions. Okay, well, how can I take my existing system and migrate it into OpenStack? Well, I use NFS and Oracle. How am I going to do that? And we're attempting to answer those questions, provide an easy path of migration and adoption. To understand the true impact that that Manila has in the database world, we have to understand the network file system and go back a ways. So NFS has been around forever. It was invented by Sun Micro in 84. It's still today the most common shared file system protocol in the storage world. It provides a flexibility and ease of deployment that is unmatched by other storage systems. I was looking through the Oracle Rack installation guide a few weeks back, and it has the various storage types you're using, and the NFS section just had one line in it. Make a share, install it, and move on to section 6. It's still the de facto enterprise database standard for many, many, many global companies. And it's trusted and proven. And, when I first started getting into this, I was coming from a different aspect. I came from a block storage background. I said, well, why NFS? And a veteran looked at me and said, why not NFS? It works. It isn't broken. Why are we trying to fix this? Exactly why should I change the way I've been doing business for 2 decades in order to come into OpenStack? And I said, well, that's a really good point. So, there's got lots of advantages, inline snapshots, the ability to access snapshots from the file system and the host itself, rather than having to have a storage administrator action, data sharing between hosts. There's just a ton of good reasons why people continue to use NFS and frankly prefer it over fiber channel or iSCSI as protocols. So just to talk about the key takeaways for today. Basically, as Rob was saying earlier, the core OpenStack maturity and stability translates to expanded use cases. And as we get into those expanded use cases, we want to lower the barriers to entry for enterprise adoption. That is a goal for many of us within OpenStack, is we want more people using this great system. And these kind of key enterprise integrations make the OpenStack tent even bigger. You know, it's already a big tent, but we're trying to expand the walls of the tent and make it even bigger, and invite people in. In services like Trove and Manila, can dramatically simplify the use of databases in the OpenStack cloud. And you know, once the critical core applications of an enterprise are in OpenStack, full migration can be achieved, and that is the ultimate goal. So with that, I'd like to hand it back over to Amrith for a minute.
Thanks, Chris. So let me put on my Trove PTL hat for a second and say there's a whole bunch of things which we're doing to make Trove better. If these are topics which are interesting to you, or if this particular topic is interesting to you, there's a session 5:20 in the evening on Wednesday. Please do attend it. If you're working on one of the other OpenStack projects, it'd be great to hear from you. But if you're somebody who's using these kinds of capabilities in your enterprise, we're really interested in your feedback on the things which we can do to make Trove better. That review is 5:20 on Wednesday. The spec itself, which I put up for review a while ago, is the line above. There is also another spec for integration for snapshot backups, which is I believe, Cinder-focused spec. And there's a full list of all the things which we're doing in Trove, a list of all the reviews if you want to comment and contribute. So that would be absolutely welcome as well. I'm going to pass it back to Rob, and then we can probably get on to Q&A. And I believe if you're interested, all three of our companies have booths in the marketplace, so please come over and see us.
Thanks, Amrith. So if you got any questions or for the open discussion, we tried to reserve about 10 minutes if you'd like to come up to the mics, or you can even huddle up here when we're done if you like. But just real quick, if you're already running OpenStack in production and you need help, all three of our companies are very well suited to help you with that. So if you're even just getting started, you want to do a POC or whatever, you've got questions about these things, here are the product and services information. For Red Hat, it's the OpenStack platform. So if you're interested in doing a Google search on that or whatever. Tesora provides a database as a service platform. So if you're interested in the open source SQL, NoSQL, or if you've got advanced needs around Oracle, you know, other proprietary databases, they can help you with that as well. And then NetApp has got just a plethora of storage options, not only for OpenStack, but other applications as well. So if you've got any questions about any of those things, Amrith has mentioned, the commercial interests are out there in the marketplace. Just stop by. You'll probably learn more than you really want to know, actually. So with that, here is the best way to get in touch with any of the three of us. We're all active on IRC. If you'd like to follow us on Twitter, email, whatever, smoke signal, however. You know, we'd love to talk to you about Trove, Database as a Service, Manila, or any other aspect of OpenStack for that matter. So just seek us out. We'd be happy to help you out. And with that, that's the end of our session. Thanks for attending. And if there are any questions, open discussion, we'd love to entertain them now. So,
Run up to the microphone.
Yeah. Okay. Well, thank you for attending. We'll be up here for a couple more minutes. Enjoy the rest of the show.